Be me, Paladin, be not me, be Kazdor, Dragon Born of Vengeance, Undris, Elf of the Ancients, Peregrine, Halfling Cook and Paladin of Redemption, Senkit, Tifling Paladin of Devotion and Dashing Good Looks, and Julian, Arsima Paladin of Buckethead's Conquest. After a successful feast and some strange dreams that either come from divine intervention or severe indigestion, the paladins awaken. Senkit explains her dream and suggests that they seek this abbey in the forest. Undris also voices her support for this. Kazdor is somewhat skeptical. I'm the exactly one for chasing after strange dreams, Julian counters. I'm inclined to believe the dream. Ancestors and spirits talk to people on a fairly regular basis, don't they? Ni saying it didn't happen, but even if it is an ancestor or a spirit, it's ni exactly a guardian angel, ni offense sen. I'm used to it. I doubt it's an ancestor though. My family has always lived in the southwest. We've certainly never come this far north. It's the rest of the dream that concerns me the most, Peregrine mutters. Wicked vines strangling the forest? A dark without star or moon? That reminds me of a few too many stories. A halfling actually scared of something? Ye gods, this is new, Julian remarks dryly. Not scared, but not foolhardy either, especially since I encountered my rather hostile brethren the other day. Something's not as it seems here, but we won't get any answers sitting around. I say we seek the abbey. Well, the wee laddie has a better head than most. I'll seek it with ye, and if it's a trap or trick ye'll be needing Meraxes, so I can e'd let ye go without me. Thus determined, the party gathers supplies from the camp, only to find that several people, including the original leader, have fallen ill. They debate staying, but the new leader tells them that they need scouting and possibly someone to go find other settlements more than they need more guards. They are holding the tower. With rations, water, and other supplies in hand, the paladins march into the forest. They briefly considered taking horses, but without any known paths, they decide it is better to be silent and able to better maneuver through the woods. Undris takes the lead, with Peregrine taking up the rear. They follow their old trail back to the stream and decide to follow it down, heading westwards through the forest, hoping that they might perhaps encounter the halflings again. After about an hour, Undris hears rough voices speaking in Goblin and calls a halt to listen. Stupid slave jits. Don't stand, stop. Kill that stupid beak bear thing. It make fine pelt cloak. I give big boss, get many shiny thanks for me. Angry raw screeching can be heard as well as much screaming. Groby ahead, and better yet something killing Groby. Kazdor says as he gets out his axes. Undris fails her nature check and isn't sure what they're dealing with. Give me a moment to get closer and see what's going on. Peregrine, I'd appreciate your help. She pulls a whistle arrow from her bag and shows it to the group. If we're spotted, I'll fire this, and you engage, otherwise hold back. The two sneaks ahead, while the others follow much further behind. Eventually they get forwards enough to see a goblin corpse go flying past them, flung by a particularly large and angry owlbear. Undris takes to a nearby tree to try to see more and sees a goblin on a wolf bossing around the others, occasionally riding in and slashing at it, but mostly staying behind his dozen or so remaining troops. Peregrine sneaks around, getting into a position to lunge out at the leader. Unfortunately, the warg smells him and turns, growling. Undris draws her bow and fires the whistle arrow into the leader's back. The sound of a high whistle and an even higher and most unmanly screech echo into the morning. Peregrine lunges forwards, driving back the warg with a pair of swift slashes, laying open its hide. The goblin looks at him with astonishment, then turns to see Undris and his jaw drops. Elf thing, scramble go. Get elf thing. Several of the goblins turn, which is a bad idea for a Groby within owlbear range, and one pays for this by having his head swept from his shoulders by a mighty paw. Highly inaccurate ranged fire rains down on her location, arrows glancing off branches and leather armor. Hearing the signal, the others charge forwards, coming into visual range. Kazdor picks up the javelin of the goblin who went flying earlier and hurls it, punching through an unfortunate goblin's petty excuse for armor and nailing him to a tree. Julian and Senkit dash forwards, Senkit leading with her shield to send another goblin flying out of her way. The warg turns and snaps at Peregrine, tearing a chunk of flesh from the halfling's shoulder, licking its lips as it savors the taste. I assure you, raw is the worst way to have any kind of meat, the cook jokes calmly as his sword becomes wreathed in flames. I personally prefer wagyu blackened. The wagyu slinks back with a whimper as the blazing blade pierces through its black hide, producing a most horrid stench, especially after Peregrine rips it free, sending scorched flesh and black blood erupting onto the forest floor, which seems to almost drink it in. Undris drops from her perch to behind the tree, leaning out from behind her cover to nail another goblin in the throat, dropping him with a gargled curse. The goblin commander turns to the halfling and swipes downwards, only for the darting blades of Avarice chosen to slap it aside. He strikes again and the nimble halfling dances to the side as he overextends and slips from his mount. The goblin group rushes forwards to try to overwhelm the strange pair that so suddenly rushed them. Scimitars slash, glancing off shield and armor, but a few lucky blows carving narrow stinging rivulets in weak points. Meanwhile, the archers continue pouring poor fire into the general area where Undris is. The owlbear, still stinging from its earlier abuse, hurtles into the goblin archer line. It crushes one under its paw before its iron beak plunges forwards, catches a goblin by the head, and crushes her skull like a nut. Kazdor charges to keep up, swiping once with his axe at the downed goblin Senkit through a side, smearing his internal organs across a nearby tree, before hitting the mob and burying his other axe in the back of one of their necks. 3. Senkit bashes one goblin to the ground with her shield and then swipes across with her Morning Star, bashing the jaw out of another's face. Julian meanwhile cleaves downwards, the superior steel, weight, and strength of his grey sword shattering through a goblin scimitar before rending its wielder from shoulder to groin. He follows through and catches the next goblin over in the side, splitting open his belly and throwing him to the ground. The wag, sensing which way the wind is blowing, abandons its rider and flees into the woods, catching a short sword to the hamstring as it runs. Peregrine turns from the cowardly mongrel and levels his blade at the fallen goblin leader. Surrender, he commands, eyes glowing with mystic authority. The wretched creature's hand shakes for a moment, before he shakes off the spell and launches himself at the halfling with a sudden fury. I will never bow kneel to slaves come, he roars as he carves a slash out of Peregrine's cheek. Undris notes the sudden drop in arrow fire due to owlbear and decides to assist it by putting a silver arrowhead inside the last archer's brain. 2. With the nearest batch of goblins of fine paste, the still very angry owlbear hurtles into the tattered remnants of the mob attacking the paladins, bowling through one and then lashing out at Senkit, who catches the beak on her shield. Kazdor hews the creature with one axe and the sole surviving goblin with the other. 4. And the beast is worth triple tay whoever slays I'm, not the time. Senkit growls as she digs in her cloven feet and shoves back into the owlbear, knocking it back and down before applying her mace to its face. Julian lunges forwards, shifting his grip on the greysword. He swings it like a batter in a home run contest, rending the owlbear's ribs asunder with a horrid cracking ripping sound. Peregrine and the goblin boss continue their duel, he landing a blow directly above the monster's heart, but deflected by the ill-fitting mail shirt, then palming his sword to cut it on the knee. The goblin responds with two deadly but inaccurate slashes that strike the air centimeters from the halfling's limbs. Undris looks from the badly wounded owlbear to the whirl of blades between the two miniature duelists, draws back her bow, sighs, and lets go. A silver arrowhead punches through the goblin boss's armor, splits his spine, and emerges through his sternum. The arrogant commander looks down in disbelief, then falls dead. 3. Nilas, that's worth double. 4. Kazdor concedes as he struggles to overcome the owlbear's tough hide, landing no telling blow, though the creature labors for breath. In a last desperate struggle, it rains claw and beak upon the dragonborn, leaving bloody rents in his scales, crimson blood running on scarlet hide and dwarven mail as he takes a single step back and shakes his head at the monster's tenacity. All for naught though, as Senkit lunges low and pushes upwards, muscles straining as she smashes the owlbear under the chin with enough force that it stands up on its back legs. The horned knight takes the opening and smashes her Morning Star through the softer underbelly and ravaged ribs into its heart, turning it into a sort of red paste not unlike strawberry jam, finally dropping the huge beast. Alright, next one of these we find we go around them. Agreed. Khazdor grudgingly admits as he patches his wounds with a combination of divine magic to close the rents, and a drink from his flask to dull the pain. He wipes his mouth and offers Peregrine a swig as the halfing mends the cut in his face and the gash in his arm. "Thanks, but I don't fancy being carried. That stuff is strong enough for someone your size, let alone a lightweight like me. Anyone else hurt? Going to be sore later after throwing the beast, but I'll be fine," Senkit says as she rolls her shield shoulder and stretches her arm. "Just my pride. Goblins are terrible shots," Andries says as she places her bow back on her back. "For all, a draw this time, beardless," she says with a grin. "I've got a beard, it's of bone and scale, knee hair. Mire than any elven pretty laddie can say," the dragon-born dwarf says crossly as he cleans off his axes in the stream and sheathes them. The party regroups, recovering arrows and checking for loot. Khazdor compulsively acquires any and all gold and silver coins, while the rest of the party claims some gems from a bag at the leader's side. Peregrine commits the bodies into the river and says a brief prayer before they move on, following the blood trail of the Wag. Following the blood trail leads them on a somewhat winding path before it crosses back into the river at a shallow ford. From here the blood trail ceases. After some debate, they decide to continue following the river until dark. As the sun dims, Senkit starts a fire. Peregrine sets his lines and net. Julian drags dead trees to form an improvised barricade around the camp, and Khazdor sets to work on repairing and maintaining the party equipment, buffing burrs and mending tears and dents with industrious hands. Andries maintains her own bow, and once that is done, she looks up to the heavens and pulls out a sheet of parchment and a quill. Peregrine looks over curiously as Andries begins to chart their position and their path through that day, marking the river and the watchtower, slowly but steadily creating a map, marking the point where they fought the bugbear and the goblins, and creating a small note of where the Wag led them. "You're a cartographer," he asks curiously as he suddenly notices one of his lines has a bite and hurries to reel it in. "Yes, since we are in an uncharted land, I thought it might be wise to record where we have been," she replies, pulling a series of small triangles and rulers from her bag to measure against the stars. "How do you keep distant?" Julian asks as he continues his fortifications. "She's using the stars, I'd imagine. Those tools aren't that different from the ones the navigators used when I came to this continent," Senkit hypothesizes as she tends the flickering flames. "That, and I've been counting our steps," she says as she continues her work. "Multiply that by the length of our stride and we should have a fairly accurate measure. We've traveled 20 miles today. A good start, for once. I'm actually glad somebody took keen mind." Andries looks upwards, slightly below the moon, to see if the moonbow is shining. "Not tonight it seems," she sighs as she puts away her tools and map. Peregrine has managed to draw in two large trout to add to tonight's dinner. Soon they are roasting on a pair of spits. Spirits are high as the paladins dig in, set watches and drift off to sleep. The night passes by quietly until Senkit's watch, as she keeps a careful eye on the dark forest around them. It passes by the witching hour, when the moon has set, and the stars are all that watch the woods. In the far dark distance, at the very edge of her vision, she can see once more, black vines pulsing like dark veins. Unseen ebony each flows at the outermost edge of her diabolical sight, where the dark is deepest. She moves closer, looking over the edge of the barricade, but the veins are only ever at the tip of her sight, but they are always there, in every direction she looks. Senkit, somewhat perturbed by this, rouses Andries and Julian, somewhat surprised to find that Andries is once again truly sleeping and not in trance. She files it away for later though as she asks them if they see what she sees. Andries looks out into the deep of the woods and indeed sees them at the very border of her sight. Julian on the other hand sees only dark woods and goes back to sleep, muttering about the halfings cooking again. The two agree that this is definitely not just the side effect of spicy trout, and Andries takes to the trees to get closer, but just as with Senkit, the vines seem to retreat, staying only ever where she can just barely make it out where the dark meets the edge of vision. As an experiment, Andries casts light on an arrow and fires it into the dark. Peering out, her elf eyes see the vines again only exist at the outermost borders of the light, vanishing and reappearing seemingly at an instant. Somewhat disturbed by this eerie phenomenon, the two agree to hold the rest of the watch together. As they stand there in the dark, they begin to chat in quiet tones. "So, Do elves in this part of the world actually sleep? Senkit asks curiously. Generally, not, but I do, she responds. HM. Are you a diviner? What? No, what gave you that idea? Looking at the stars, wearing a moonbow on your back, and trying to dream. How did you know I was trying to dream? Lucky guess. The oracles would do something similar. Drink a special brew, smoke a certain plant, and look for the divine in strange dreams. Occasionally they'd find something that's not a tradition I've heard of. Where are you from anyways? It's a continent called Chult. Several weeks sail south and west from the southernmost ports. Quite a long way then. What made you decide to leave? That's somewhat personal. I'll tell you if you tell me why you're trying to dream. Bargaining run in the family. Only about as much as randomly swapping sexes runs in yours. Point taken, sorry. I'm used to it. So, are you going to tell me? Andres considers it for a few moments, and then sighs. Seems I'll have to tell someone at some point, and may as well be someone who's willing to fight alongside me. Do you know what happens in trance? It's basically like a better version of sleep, right? You're more aware and get rested in half the time, right? Not exactly. Well, not just that. In trance, an elf relives memories, memories of both our current lives, and for the oldest and the youngest amongst us, memories of our past lives. HM, I'd heard that Corellon spat elf souls back out into new bodies, never realized they can remember the old bodies they had. A bit cruder than I'd have put it, but more or less that's how it's supposed to work. Yes, you say supposed to work. I take it that there are times when it doesn't. Yes, and you're one of those times, so you dream hoping you'll remember an old life. Yes, does it ever work? Andres grimaces, rubbing the back of her head through her pale hair. Occasionally, either that or they're just normal nightmares. Nothing good, but at least there's something. Alright, your side of the bargain now. Long story short, religion and family issues. Do you remember the soul plague that happened about 10 years ago? Right, I was just finishing my training when that whole mess ended. Wasn't it some lick trying to become a god? Asurake, that's the one. I was 12 when they destroyed him. That was all that anyone talked about. Of course not everyone looked at the soulmonger's death the same way. Some people thought that it posed a remarkable opportunity to gobble up the rather huge number of souls that were released. I take it this is where the family issues came in. Right. To make a very long story short, the same people who destroyed Asurake wound up dealing with this particular cult, including a certain paladin by the name of Saravidor. It was him who wound up taking me in after that whole mess. He trained me, and eventually he left me in charge of the small shrine to Pella we'd built there. I take it something happened to the shrine? Uobtau happened. Who's Uobtau? He's the god of Chult, a primordial actually. After the whole soulmonger incident, he offered the people who destroyed that monster rather remarkable amounts of power. They all accepted, except Arvidor. Uobtau held a grudge. So, one day an earthquake strikes, wipes out the shrine, and then about 20 odd dinosaurs show up to make sure the shrine stays wiped out. I was smart enough to not stay on a continent with an angry god, and was on the first boat out of there, admittedly without a ticket. Wound up working my way out of there, and from there just kept traveling northeast, kind of hoping I can find Arvidor. Any trace? None. Every lead I had seemed to suggest he's on another plane, whether he's traveling or dead, can't be sure. Still, I'll figure out eventually. For now, the gods have me here, and here's where I'll keep fighting. They passed the rest of the night in silence, Senkit eventually bedding back down at Andri's insistence. The paladins awakened slightly groggy, Senkit particularly so. To deal with the grogginess, she begins boiling water, and then adds a packet of what looks like dirt and smells rich and bitter. What in the nine hells is that? Julian asks. Coffee. It's a bean that grows where I'm from and a few other places on this continent. When you grind it up and boil it, it gives people the equivalent of a few extra hours of sleep. You're welcome to some. Julian and Kazdor decline, but Andres and Peregrine take her up on the offer. Both are slightly horrified at the taste, but Seng casually sips hers while they discuss the strange visions of last night and determine their next course of action. The paladins decide to continue following the river, and Peregrine suggests that they create a raft to speed their travels. After a few hours of work, they are successful and ride along their merry way, Peregrine acting as captain while Kazdor, Julian, and Senkit handle poling. Around midday they are busy eating their midday meal when Andres and Peregrine's ears perk up at the sudden sound of rushing water. Looking ahead, the party sees the land begin to fall away and the river running in a series of rapids and cataracts down with it. Kazdor leaps to his feet to try to get to the pole, unbalancing the raft and falling out for his troubles. Julian tosses him a line while Senkit sizes the pole and tries to push them ashore. Pergerite secures the food and his pack, and Andres ties a second line to an arrow, firing it into a nearby tree. Kazdor flounders slightly, cursing loudly in dwarfish as the rapid current starts to pull him and the raft into the cataracts. Julian heaves for all he's worth to try to pull the angry dragonborn in. Senkit pushes hard against the current. Peregrine grabs the tree line to try to hold them fast but instead begins being pulled from the raft, Andres diving to catch him and sliding off as well, holding onto his ankles as he holds onto the rope. Despite their best efforts, the raft goes over, as does Kazdor. Julian, in desperation, flares his wings and takes flight, unable to haul the dragonborn out of the water, but able to keep his head above water. As Senkit realizes the futility of trying to break free, she swipes outwards with the pole and manages to push Andres aside into the shallows where the tall elf can stand upright. Andres and Peregrine manage to use the rope to pull themselves ashore, and Julian keeps dry in the air. Kazdor takes a few bashes to his legs and one to his manhood, prompting a wheezing cough. Senkit, on the other hand, hands on for dear life to the raft as it rolls and pitches before her grip slips and she goes flying. By sheer luck though, she lands on the bough of a nearby tree, her tunic caught in the branches. Peregrine offers a small prayer to Yolanda in thanks as the raft leaps from atop the nearby rocks and crashes off the stream, breaking upon a rocky bar. Kazdor limps out of the steam. "Take a raft, Wot," he says. "It'll be easy and peaceful," he says. "Fucking halflings," he curses as he sits down and judiciously applies some healing magic and equally judiciously applies alcohol to his throat. One minor throttling of Peregrine later, the party gets Senkit down from her tree and spends a few hours retrieving their supplies and drying off them to frequent use of thaumaturgy. They continue on for the next few hours until the dark sets in and they set up camp. Fortunately, Andres' map and cartography supplies were in their case, so the map continues. Another night haunted by shadow vines passes without incident, though the party can hear the howling of wolves in the distance. None can tell if this is more goblin riders or just wolves being wolves. In any case, they douse the fire and sleep with one eye open. In the morning, they march onwards, until they see the woods beginning to thin and spy a bridge in the distance, with two towers on each side. Andres approaches stealthily and observes that this old bridge, most likely of dwarven and human make, has been occupied by yet more hobgoblins, though they haven't set up a fortified encampment. The party considers how to deal with the problem. They fully intend to take the bridge, but they cannot assault one side without the other being able to send for reinforcements. As such, they decide to attack from three sides. Andres and Senkit will attack from one side of the river, while Kazdor and Peregrine attack from the other. In the meanwhile, Julian will swim through the river, fly onto the bridge from the center, and strike into the back lines of whatever side seems weaker. Julian loans Kazdor his crossbow, then Peregrine and Kazdor swim across the river and move to the tree line on one side, watching the bridge and road. There are two crossbowmen, one in each tower, a guard at the foot of each tower, and two guards in the center of the bridge who have sat down and started playing cards. On the opposite side, Senkit and Andres see a similar scene, although the guards on the bridge proper are busy discussing something in their rough tongue. Julian hangs back at tree line, waiting for things to start before he starts swimming. The rest of the party takes aim. A stone flies, a bolt looses, an elven bow sings, and a bolt of hellfire screams through the late morning light. Kazdor's shot goes wide, Peregrine's stone cracks across a crossbow hob's hand, leaving broken bones in a stinging welt. The recipient of the silver arrow falls quietly, one, while the unfortunate woman set ablaze does not go quietly, but rather begins screaming as her hair is engulfed in purple flames. Julian takes that for his signal and plunges beneath the chill waters towards the bridge. The confused hobgoblins turn towards their screaming comrade, but the slung hob barks a warning that they're on the other side as well. Peregrine confirms this by hitting him in the mouth with another bullet. Andres finishes the blazing hobgoblin, muttering two under her breath. Khazad-dûr takes more careful aim and picks off the unwounded hobgoblin with a lucky shot to the eye. 1. Julian continues closer, swimming forwards to the bridge until its shadow passes over him, then he surfaces. Senkit leaves the cover of the tree line, charging forwards into the very surprised hobgoblins and smashing one of the tower guards over the side of the head. The surviving crossbow hobgoblin ducks back into the tower away from the stinging missiles. Meanwhile, the rest of that side leaps to their feet and begins advancing in a phalanx towards Khazad-dûr and Peregrin. Across the bridge, the bludgeoned hobgoblin takes a swipe at Senkit, which she catches on her shield. The others begin moving in, but only one gets close enough to take another strike with his halberd, which her mail turns aside. Peregrin spots the hob who hasn't yet had time to properly link up with the phalanx and charges him, two swords opening two long cuts in his legs. Undris finishes the wounded hobgoblin, expertly placing an arrow through the melee under Senkit's arm directly into his abdomen. 2. Khazad-dûr smiles at the phalanx and punishes their tight formation with a gout of flame from his jaws, scorching their shields and forcing them to scatter. Julian erupts from the river, wings raised in all their angelic glory as he dives towards the hobgoblins attacking Senkit. The rearmost one turns in utter shock, just barely able to get his shield up in time to deflect the grey sword falling like a guillotine towards him. Senkit sidesteps, putting the wall at her left side to keep from being flanked as she lays into another hob, the crude scale mail keeping his ribs intact. Wary now, the phalanx scatters, one breaking off to aid his comrade, who very successfully murders the ground next to Peregrin. The other two circle him, cautiously striking, one from each side, and each repulsed by dwarven armor and skillfully wielded axes. Across the bridge, the blue-nosed hob realizes he's been pincered, and in desperation launches an all-out assault on Julian, forsaking his shield to use both hands on his longsword. He is rewarded with the sudden red stain blossoming upon his tunic. Meanwhile, his minions prove unable to break through Senkit's iron defenses. Peregrin rolls under the hobgoblin's legs, cutting them out from under him and then executing the downed Silida with a stab through the back of his neck. Undris keeps the pressure on, catching another goblin in the shoulder. Senkit follows through, breaking his guard, then his neck. Meanwhile, Khazad-dûr lays into the weaker hobgoblin, the one who took more of a burning from his breath. The first axe splits the shield, the second, the skull. 2. Julian strikes the hob leader right in his blue nose with his pommel, stunning him just long enough to slip around his guard and lay open his side with a lunging stab. The hobgoblin leader looks across the bridge and sees that there is no escape to be found there, so he takes his chances, disengaging and fleeing, clutching his wounded side. Across the way, the crossbowman pokes his head up and sees just about all his friends are dead. He runs the numbers, and then takes aim with his crossbow, and fires. His former commander lies dead with the crossbow bolt in his back an instant later. The last hobgoblin launches a desperate assault on Khazad-dûr's turned back, laying it open and breathing easier for just a moment before Khazad-dûr turns around growling. Meanwhile, his friend manages to land a shallow cut across Peregrin's forehead. Peregrin swipes, the blood flowing into his eye ruining the strike. The hobgoblin smacks it down and traps the blade under his foot. However, the goblinoid failed to realize the orientation of the sword as he went to trap it, and accidentally cuts his own foot in half. Peregrin is so embarrassed for him he strikes him with the flat of the blade and knocks him out. Undris is surprised to see the blue nose go down, and her eye tracks the shot's likely path back to the traitor. She knows she should feel disgust, but can't help but feel a certain strange respect for a well-executed backstab. Khazad-dûr makes the surviving loyal hob regret striking him in the back, and ever being born for that matter. Blood is not the only of that poor bastard's fluids pooling out around his newly headless body. Julian flies up to the treacherous marksman, who throws down his weapon and places his hands behind his head. "I surrender," he says in rough common. After retrieving their arrows and once again looting the bodies, Undris and Khazad-dûr return to the tower where Julian is busy interrogating the traitor. Apparently, these hobgoblins serve the same master as the ones at the watchtower. The traitor, named Swart, was press-ganged into serving them after their captain, a ferocious warlord and servant of Magulabit named Cluny, conquered his village. Cluny and his horde came down out of the north years ago and had briefly settled in the ruined city of Zanjonas. driving out the former kobold inhabitant. However, they were in turn driven out by a roving orc warband who had driven them out of the city with heavy losses, forcing them to retreat to the south, where they found an ancient abbey with walls of blood red stone. Tlany apparently declared the place a holy site and has been using it as his base ever since, gathering his strength and locking down any paths and transport nexuses in the area in preparation to march once more on Zanjonas to retake the ruined city once more. Senkit starts slightly at the mention of the abbey and asks if there had been a tiefling when they had taken it. Swart says there wasn't. Senkit asks about the dark vines at night, and Swart looks at her like she's crazy. Meanwhile, Peregrine revives his captive, named Eort, and he corroborates Swart's story, with the additional comment to not trust Swart. After acquiring the location of the abbey 2 days' march south on the road and the location of Zanjonas a week to the north, the party debates what to do with their captives. Julian wants to bring them along, Peregrine wants to bring along Eort but not Swart. Snekit agrees, Kazdor wants to kill them both, and Undris abstains. After a few minutes of tense debate, majority rules, Eort agrees to come along, while Swart couldn't be happier to be getting out of there. A rather tense argument about whether or not to give Eort his weapons ensues, and a compromise is reached where he is allowed to keep his armor and a quarterstaff, but Kazdor holds on to his shield, sword, and crossbow. With a new goal in mind, the party turns their eyes southwards, and marches onwards towards the Bloodystone Abbey, and onwards towards destiny.
I really do enjoy this story night. I love it a bit. I think it's one of the better ones that I've actually done in a while. I love a lot of like the role-playing aspects and the, you know, the characters sitting talking to each other. It feels like something we haven't really got since, like, you know, well, I suppose you do get it in Shadowgun, but it's something like, not since, be honest with you, the old guardsman party, you know, that amount of character development and stuff. And I don't know, I just love all that type of shit. So I do. But hey, look, I hope you guys have enjoyed this here voice. I actually kind of like it better, so I do. I actually like this one better than my old voice. It's certainly better than the last one I was using in the last video. But like at the minute, it looks like the software that I've been using, it's just not supporting the voice anymore. The voice that I have been using, the voice from all my other videos is Darren, or sometimes called Brian. So if any of you guys, like, you know, have any idea on how to get it, or, you know, I've been scouring the internet for a few days and I really just haven't been able to come up with anything. So, like, you know, if any of you guys know of anything, definitely let me know in the comments down below. It would help me out big time. Seriously, it really would. It's a fucking disaster, let's be honest with you. But, like, I really like the voice that I'm using here at the minute, like, now. Not my actual voice. Oh, fuck. You wouldn't want any of that. The text-to-speech voice in this video. I really enjoy it. So I might actually keep using this one, be honest with you. I'll see what you guys make of it, and we'll just work from there. But personally, I see myself using this voice a lot more than what I have. Anyway, I really enjoyed it. I enjoyed it that much. I've actually recorded a ton of more audio for this here, the All Paladin Party, so I have. So, like, enough of me rambling. Hope you boys enjoyed, and I'll see you in the next video. Also, there's so many more parts to go. Remember to subscribe and all that other good stuff so you catch it. Alrighty, I'll see you then.
So I've recently moved Ickbeardian merch over to Teesprings and have a few new designs. Listings are below the video and in the description.
Just stop! Just stop it! Stop! No! Just stop it! It's time to stop! It's time to stop, okay? No more! Where the fuck are your parents? Who are your parents? I'm gonna call Child Protective Services! It's time to stop!